of a rating that Cheryl Jackson-Harris has long time been in our portal learning almost from the beginning when we discovered ebooks really matched a lot of, or the library's ebooks matched quite a few of the textbooks that were being used on campus.
Well, here.
Yeah.
You can't use this one.
My presentation will be very fast and low tech. Naomi asked me to give a short talk on how we're using the e-learning to benefit the students, the textbooks, in some of our classes. So what I concluded. I think we missed one. This is it. The usage in clinical science for our courses, again, clinical science is an applied science, laboratory medicine science. These are the courses currently with instructors who are using, their students have access to the free textbooks. So, of course, CLS 304 is a study of your male assistants, body fluids, and all that kind of good stuff. So I have 46 students enrolled this semester, and the textbook, if one were to purchase it, and I think the bookstores are even a little higher, but this, I'm not sure, this is a publisher price I got off the web, is $59.95. If they were going to go through Amazon, they could get a text between $52 and $57. So to read this, so our 306, which is immunology, serology, and transfusion medicine, you can see they meet enrollment, very large classes. We teach large lectures with multiple lab sections. So we have 69 lectures, 3 labs of 23 each. Required, absolutely required, 2 textbooks for that course. So you can see the price of that, $167. The students, but on Amazon it would be half if they went through between the use days. In hematology, and of course I teach, it's a nice large lecture, 69 with 3 lab sections, 23 each. That text is extremely expensive, and it's 118. And I selected that because it's one of the less expensive ones. And we can go as high as 200 for one text. Unfortunately, that text is not available through the program. But our mandatory lab atlas is available, and I think because we're high users on that. And it's $73.95, and then you can see the prices on Amazon. One of our more expensive books is not the most expensive. We have a textbook that the students have to pay up to $500 for. But what we do for that textbook is in our cytology, pathology. We purchase that book through membership in professional societies. We get about, I myself or with instructors will purchase using a professional membership. We get a 20% discount, and then the students somehow. Sometimes they don't reimburse us, sometimes they do. But the book is $450, and we'll have their membership. So what happens is, so in our MedTech internship, I have 46 students in that program, and they have a required reference text, which runs $171, and she's able to get that on boards. There are some caveats to those really, really expensive books. They have very limited answers. So that's a little background. Now, I did a quick survey Tuesday because I said, what am I going to talk about here? And I'm low tech, so it's not on Clicker and all that other stuff. I just passed out a 4-question survey. I didn't put the 4th one there. But I thought these were interesting. We have 46 students, and I got 40 responses. And as you can see, the first question, did you purchase your book? Free book through the system. Unfortunately, only 14 students did. And then I get 24, no, and absolutely 2 who said, I don't know what you're talking about. And this is on the syllabus. The link is there. So I did ask them to put names, so it would be interesting to see if those are the 2 students failing the class. And then what was the benefit of using the service? And 12 of 14 who said yes, saving money was the big thing you have to say. And then the two of those responses were, because it's accessible when I'm on it, you know, they carry their mobiles and everything else. And then they don't have to carry heavy textbooks around when they're backpacks. So that was interesting. And then the disadvantage I thought was interesting. Difficult to navigate, difficult to use the service and not get more than exams. And that was pretty much universal on the users because it's too many people waiting until the last minute and they're using it. And downloading big chapters would be difficult. They lose the stream. And also some of those says printing, if they print hard copies, is sometimes disjointed. That can be a problem. Eye strain, I found that interesting for young people. I know I'm an older person and I have eye strain now from all of the reading the small text and then all of the electronic things. And then I had those who said no. It's interesting. Four of them, they really like hard copies, so they can mark them up, highlight, make their notes, and they just prefer to have the old-fashioned hard copy. And then two people, and that came up about accessibility at home, they said they can't use these things, they have no access to them. So, you know, we think that we're in the EH for everybody, but not everybody has what we think they should. So I thought that was interesting. And so how do I use this? Now, my personal interest as far as my discipline since the 80s has been with digital microscopic imaging. I was, before I came, I transitioned to education when I was in hospital practice. I was in 85 for a corporation, I don't know if you guys, it's probably, I think it's no longer exists, PerkinElmer. They were the first corporation to put digital imaging in medicine out. And one of my jobs, yes, my role in the hospital, I was the beta site manager for the Southern California testing sites for the company was located in Connecticut. And they use what we call pattern recognition. If any of you are familiar with digital imaging, which was awful. And so I've been working with digital imaging systems since the mid-80s. So I have this niche, I love this. And then when I came here, I used the laser disc one for teaching. I was going to work with them to put some of the early imaging systems together. And so how do we use this for our laboratories? And my immunology instructor also, we have mandatory, they must have a picture book. I mean, really, so they can't, and that's what an atlas is, a picture book, or a methodology book. And so we're fortunate in our student lab, we have stations with internet connection. And so the students can hook in, can get Wi-Fi also. So what we have is I have an extensive collection of pathology slides, what we call glass slides. And that's where you look at it under a microscope and you make decisions. And I've been collecting slides since the 60s. And people all over my field, you know, when they want a digital textbook, I get requests, can you send me the original? To prevent copyright, because everybody knows I have like that. I must have 10,000 class slides in my possession, and they'll request for certain diseases. So anyhow, this is an example. The way I do this is the atlas. This is just a picture, the image of what's available, and then this is inside of the atlas is the actual picture, the image that will be shown, and then the students have their microscope. And they have their glass slide. And they can match the actual thing under the microscope and then with the image that's presented hard copy. And then what else I've taught them to do, so and this preserves my legs, because I'm not running around for 23 students in each lab section, is I tell them to use your phones and or your digital cameras. I had a collection of blood slides at what's that, Sammy? Is that the camera director? Because I brought him in way back, and they noticed way in the mid, like about 98 or so. How'd you get all these slides from me? I said, oh, I played around with it. So they asked me, so they put up a display of the use way back then of how you could use digital cameras or now the cell phones. So I tell all the students, I said, okay, what I want you to do, when I give you, they have in this class 200 unknown slides to look at. This happens to be, I'll tell you, this is, you're probably saying, what the heck are you looking at? This is a disease called hemoglobin homozygous C, and it's on the same plane as sickle cell lymphomas. So they have to look for these changes in the blood, the normal disc shape of blood cells, and be able to identify and say, because I see these crystalline structures and these targeting cells, that this is representative morphologically of this disease called homozygous C. And so that's how we use it. We teach that, and then the students, so it reduces my time, like I said, running around. I said, take your cameras or bring your nice digital camera. Take your pictures, come up to me with your picture if you have a problem, and then we'll do it. And they've been able to save their libraries of their imaging, and then they go back and look at their atlas. So I have another one, and this one is easier. This is sickle cell anemia, blood smear, hemoglobin SS. And so this is what the atlas looks like. This is the slide that the student has in their unknown box that they take that, they compare it, they take their picture, and they make their own digital atlas for them. So we've seen, you know, I mean, it works. It's not as high tech as, you know, you guys with the apps, although there are lots of digital pathology apps that students can use available free of charge now. So this is one method that in clinical science that we use, and I think you can see by the cost savings. Those in one semester, clinical science students, I just did in our textbooks, but they always take biology and chem classes, and those textbooks are extremely expensive. So they can incur per semester up to $500 plus in book charges. So, you know, I really appreciate Julie's efforts for, and she finds, she knows our textbooks. Oh, I have something new for you, you know, we'll see if we can do this. So it's gonna help. Okay, any questions? So this was just an application, low tech, of how and the advantages of having this service to our students. Okay.
Are there any questions? I do want to comment that yes, we do, you know, sometimes have problems with the e-textbooks. And I just need to also go out and have a group of us teach a little bit more of what the books can do, because you can actually highlight in the books. You can even drop web pages addresses into the books and then click on them. And you can actually make PDF copies. Now, it might not be so great with these particular books, but for some of the other courses, it's really fine to make PDF copies that are your permanent copies, and it's legal when we own the textbook rights to that, and we do for many of our books. And we're going to try to talk about that a little in the other sessions. But it looks like right now that lunch is here, and